Freeholders, Duffy, James, Lazara, Kapoor, Laura, Deputy Director Bartlett, Director Best.
Here. Thank you, everyone. And this is a very special month for us, as it is Asian Pacific American Heritage Month. And one of our colleagues, Freeholder John Bartlett, did an outstanding job putting together this wonderful program that we have here today. So with that being said, I will turn it over to him. Freeholder Bartlett, your show.
Good evening.
This is our fourth annual celebration of the Asian Pacific American Heritage Month, and it's a privilege throughout the year for us as freeholders to gather and recognize all of the different and diverse communities that make up Passaic County. Already this year, we've enjoyed African American Heritage Month in February, Irish American and Women's History Month in April, also recognize important communities such as the autism community, as we did in April, recognizing families here in Passaic County that are affected by and activists on that issue. But it's a particular personal pleasure and privilege for me every year to celebrate Asian Pacific American Heritage Month because it's something that is particularly close to me as by, having married someone who's originally from India. The Asian story, the Asian American immigration story since 1965 is also now part of my family story. We are privileged in Passaic County to have a tremendous number of people from the Asian American communities who are part of the service that we do. Some of them are among the other notables that you see in the slideshow above me and that you'll be able to watch throughout the evening. People like Aziz Rahman, who is a member of our Bangladeshi American community in Patterson and Prospect Park, who serves on our Passaic County Board of Social Services, and in conjunction with whom we were able to roll out information in the Bengali language for people who needed information about the family and other services that are provided at the Board of Social Services. From my town of Wayne, Mr. Bipin Shukla served on our Senior Citizens Advisory Committee, and Bhupendra Gadvi, who actually was here a couple of years ago when we honored Vivekananda Vidyapith from Wayne. Bhupendra now serves on our Open Space and Farmland Preservation Advisory Committee. We are also very happy to have added to our employee ranks last year Ms. Shirali Patel, who serves in our County Assessor's Office, County Adjuster's Office as a legal associate and is also a native of Passaic County. And Shirali, I'd like to introduce you to begin our program with the flag salute. Jariwala. And Bhavna, Ben, if you would be so kind as to introduce your girls and say a word or two about what they'll be performing.
I'm so happy to be here. I'm here first time, but it's going to be, I know I'm very excited for today. And I hope so you're going to enjoy that performance. And this performance is about the like a Guru Vandana. And it will be that all kids is like between 6 and 10 years old. So I hope so you're going to enjoy this performance for tonight. And thank you so much for inviting me tonight. Thank you.
Excuse me. Could you stand back a little bit? Thank you.
Say goodbye.
Wasn't that wonderful? Bubba, bring your girls back up. We want to thank you guys for being here and present to the dance troupe and to each of the girls a certificate for your day here and to say thank you for coming out and being part of this very exciting celebration. Where's Tina? Koopa? Vika? Now I remember your name. And who's Mila?
One more for you. Ready? One, two.
Thank you.
Figures like Maya Lin, and if you pay attention in among them, you'll find people who represented you here in Passaic County or others here in New Jersey, like the Pender Chibukula and the Raj Mukherjee, both from the State Assembly. It's our privilege today to honor two exceptional examples of what Asian Americans are doing in and for Passaic County. The first person that I want to call up is Gilman Chowdhury. There are some awards that are tough to figure out who to give to, and there are some that are very, very easy. And if you're Facebook friends with Gilman, you know that this was an easy choice, because I don't think a week goes by that he's not posting some just wonderful, hopeful and inspiring story about the students that he works with and the things that they're achieving. But I can't say it better than this long and very densely worded proclamation. So I'm going to take a moment of privilege to read this into the record for you. Gilman. Whereas the month of May has been designated as Asian Pacific American History Month in recognition of the outstanding achievements and contributions made to the United States by immigrants from Asia and the Pacific Islands and their descendants, the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic deems it fitting and appropriate at this time to honor and recognize Gilman Chowdhury. And whereas Gilman Chowdhury was born in Bangladesh and immigrated to the United States with his parents when he was 8 months old to the city of Paterson, where he attended school number 13, school number 5, and graduated from John F. Kennedy High School. He enrolled at Montclair State University and earned a Bachelor's of Arts in History. He then enlisted in the U.S. Army Reserve, where he trained as a petroleum supply specialist, attended graduate school at Montclair State University, earning 2 graduate certificates in human sexuality education and community development, and he is currently studying for his master's in child advocacy and policy. And whereas Gilman Chowdhury works for the Department of Family and Community Engagement of the Paterson Public School System as the Community Outreach and Special Project Supervisor, where he works to help remove academic barriers and give greater access to students and families. And whereas, as the lead manager for the College Ready Family Mentorship Program, Gilman has supported and encouraged many students to apply for academic scholarships, such as the Dell Foundation Scholarship, Horatio Alger Scholarship, and the Alexander Hamilton Scholarship, And in the last 5 years, listen carefully to this, in the last 5 years, he has helped Patterson students earn at least $400,000 in college scholarships. And whereas Gilman Chowdhury also helps support his students to compete for state and national level awards in the fields of robotics, computer science, and engineering. And recently, the high school robotics team he mentors won second place in the New Jersey statewide robotics competition. And whereas Gilman Chowdhury in his college prep role has had numerous students get into some of the top academic schools in the country, such as Columbia University, Stanford University, and Western State University of New Jersey. And these students have been accepted into such universities thanks to the academic rigor he provides them, from SAT, extra SAT classes to the engineering program. He has given these students the support they need to be recruited by these elite schools. And whereas Gilman Chowdhury has been instrumental in creating and maintaining School Number 5's Elysian Fields Community Food Garden, with support from the Passaic County Board of Chosen Freeholders through the City Green Dig-In Program. And the garden not only supports the academic and social education of the students, but also helps families who need fresh food but can't afford it. And whereas at Gilman Chowdhury's initiative, the school also received a project grant from Rutgers University and the Passaic County Sewage Commission to install a 2,500-gallon rainwater harvesting tank, which is one of only two such projects of the kind awarded in the state. And, well, not them. Whereas Gilman Chowdhury has hosted successful medical service fairs at schools around Patterson, offering eye exams, HIV testing, cancer screenings, asthma screenings, and other basic health services. And these fairs are now held 5 times every year. Now, therefore, being proclaimed by the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic, that it hereby publicly recognizes and applauds Gilman Chowdhury for the significant contributions he has made in the exemplary service he has devoted to the community, and be it further proclaimed that this board extends its sincere best wishes to Gilman Chowdhury for many years of continued success.
Good evening, everyone. The first thing I want to say is I can't take any credit for this still. It's all because of the great people that I've been able to, been blessed to work around with, such as my former interns, Chris and Angeli. Hi, guys. There you go. And I do have to say, though, the amazing kids that I've been able to have an opportunity to help, such as Frank Carlos Castro. He's just finished his first year in Columbia University. He's going to be a computer science major. And he's an example of some of the kids that I've been really fortunate to meet and help. And, you know, I can't say that without the support of them, without people around me, a lot of the work that's been done in Patterson would have gotten done. And I'm really blessed and happy to say that the Passaic County Freeholders here have been really supportive of everything from all the different initiatives, from the programs, and really it's a team atmosphere that really gets stuff done, and I'm really appreciative of that. And what I want to also say lastly is that, you know, I truly appreciate my parents, my father and mother especially. They always told me to make sure that I always made the right decision and always did the moral thing. And it's because of them I always try to do whatever I can to help the community out. And if it wasn't for them, I guess I wouldn't be here where I am right now. So thank you, everyone.
So our second honoree this evening is the BAPS, or BAPS, Sri Swaminarayan Mandir in Clifton. I'm sure many of you have noticed it on Bloomfield Ave, not far from the highway. I've had the privilege of going there on a number of occasions. And the service that it renders, not only to its own community, but to the broader Clifton and Passaic County community, which is a part, is tremendous, and I'm so glad they abbreviated BAPS, so I only have to, at the very first reading, pronounce Boshasun Wasi Akshar Purushottam Satsa. So, the BAPS, Mandir. Whereas the month of May has been designated as Asian Pacific American History Month in recognition of the outstanding achievements and contributions made to the United States by immigrants from Asia and the Pacific Islands and their descendants, the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic deems it fitting and appropriate at this time to honor and recognize the BAPS Temple. And whereas the BAPS Temple in Clifton was inaugurated and opened to the public in October 2000, by the BAPS movement spiritual leader, Pramukh Swami Maharaj. And whereas BAPS is a socio-spiritual Hindu organization which strives to care for the world by caring for societies, families, and individuals, and its universal work has received many national and international awards and affiliation with the United Nations. And whereas BAPS and its sister organization, BAPS Charities, work together to help those in need with humanitarian efforts that reach people all over the world and from all walks of life, particularly in the areas of education, the environment, and healthcare. And whereas BAPS Charities Clifton has been engaging in a wide array of charitable activities and community projects in Clifton, while also supporting charitable projects around the world. And BAPS Charities harnesses the efforts and collective spirit of volunteers in Clifton and its surrounding communities to serve individuals, families, and communities. And whereas BAPS Charities have recently provided humanitarian and disaster relief in the Fort McMurray Wildlife Relief Fund with emergency shelter, food, and transportation to hundreds of distressed people, and to the Nepal Earthquake Relief Fund with medical equipment, shelter, water, sanitation, emergency health, food, and protection. And whereas BAPS Clifton hosts health fairs to provide a convenient platform for physicians and other healthcare providers to volunteer their expertise and provide medical care and advice to individuals who may lack access to quality healthcare, and also sponsors an annual blood donation drive, annual Children's Health and Safety Day, quarterly health awareness lectures, and annual walkathons to support medical charities like the American Diabetes Association and American Cancer Society. And whereas BAPS Clifton sponsors educational services by offering students an opportunity to learn more about the opportunities available to them beyond high school, hosts annual regional leadership seminars for youth, and sponsors weekly music lessons and public speaking lessons. And whereas BAPS Clifton supports environmental protection and preservation projects which benefit the Nature Conservancy's Plant a Billion Trees Initiative in an effort to restore and replant over 1.6 billion acres of natural space, and also sponsors aluminum can recycling. And whereas BAPS provides community empowerment and spiritual growth by encouraging individuals to live addiction-free lifestyles, which helps individuals focus their energy towards personal success and then give back to their community. It also provides a platform for children and youth to develop their talents and skills in order to better serve and lead in their communities by organizing and encouraging activities that help foster a cohesive family unit, including daily family assembly, family outings, and marital counseling for young couples. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Board of Chosen Freeholders of the County of Passaic that it hereby publicly recognizes and applauds BAPS Clifton for the significant contributions that they've made and the exemplary service that is devoted to the community, and be it further proclaimed that this board extends its sincere best wishes to this organization for continued success.
Good evening. Thank you very much, John. Thank you very much for this honor. I would not be here accepting this honor without the blessings of our spiritual leader, Pramukh Swami Maharaj, who at the age of 95 inspired us to become the ideal citizen of the community, and also to the volunteer force of the BAPS Clifton, who dedicate their time and energy in the community activities. We take great pride in our community outreach programs, and we strongly believe that spirituality and the community services go hand in hand. And on a separate note, on Sunday, June 12th at 9 a.m. in Clifton, we'll be holding our annual walkathon, and it is my pleasure to invite each of the freeholders as well as everyone who's in session today. This year we are raising funds for the Nature Conservancy in its effort to plant and restore 1.6 million acres of land by planting 1 billion trees by 2025 through the Plant a Billion Tree Initiative. And on behalf of BAPS, I deeply appreciate your honor. Thank you very much.
So
much. Last year, we recognized the 50th anniversary of the Immigration Reform Act of 1965, which is actually what opened America's doors to immigration from Asia for the first time in half a century. And it's exciting as we embark on the second half century, as we start seeing the second generation and the third generation of Asian Pacific Americans. It's going to be exciting to see what more they do and what more we accomplish together. So on that note, I'd like to thank everyone so much for being part of the program today, and have a wonderful evening. Join us up here for a photograph with the Freeholder Board.
These are all status shots.
For the most part.
Yeah, we can do
it. For the dance.
Yeah.
But you know what? It doesn't come out blurry, you know?
Very rarely. Can you capture video on it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Supposedly, I don't know how, but yeah.
We should down. Let's start.
We're going to move forward with our review of our consent agenda. Item N1 through N, or N1, excuse me, N01 and O35. O1 through O35. Are there any questions besides the difference between 0 and O?
We just have an amendment director for N1.
Right, is there a need for an executive session?
No.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Seeing that, entertain a motion to adjourn our consent agenda, conference agenda. Moved by Freeholder McCord, second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara, McCord,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Bass,
yes. We'll now move into our regular public meeting for May 24th, 2016. Start with the reading of our Open Public Meetings Law.
Ladies and gentlemen, the notice requirement of the Open Public Meetings Law has been satisfied with respect to this meeting, specifying the time, date, and location, including the annual notice, adopted the reorganization meeting, filed with the county clerk, posted in the administration building, and mailed to two newspapers in accordance with the provisions of the law.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy, James, Lazara, Lepore, Laura,
here.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
here.
Director Bass,
here. Thank you. Ask everyone to please stand for our invocation, flag salute.
Thank you.
flag of our country, salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'm going to ask that everyone please remain standing for a special moment of silence for all the brave men and women who gave their lives while serving this great country. Thank you. Entertain a motion to approve the minute from May 10th, 2016. Moved by Freeholder Laura, second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara, LaFour, Laura, Deputy Director Bartlett, Director Best.
Yes. Trying to hold off, we need Freeholder Bartlett in here. Thank you. Motion to suspend regular order of business. Moved by Freeholder Laura. Second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara.
Yes.
LaFour.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Best.
Yes. We now have the reading of our guarantee ordinance 2016-07.
Resolution authorizing the guarantee by the County of Passaic, New Jersey, of payment of principal and of interest on the governmental loan revenue bond anticipation notes, Series 2016, Passaic County Guarantee, City of Patterson Project, of the Passaic County Improvement Authority, in aggregate principal amount not to exceed $14,395,000.
Thank you. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to open the public hearing on guarantee ordinance 2016-07.
I'll move it. Second.
Moved by Freeholder Lazara, second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara, LaFour,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Best.
Yes. At this time, anyone wishing to be heard on bond guarantee ordinance 2016-07, please approach the podium.
Seeing no one, make a motion to close.
Motion made by Freeholder LaFour, second by Freeholder Bartlett. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara,
yes.
LaFour,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Before we take this motion, I just want to remind Freeholders that we need 5 votes in order for this motion to pass. That being said, I'll entertain a motion to adopt bond ordinance 2016-07.
Move it.
Moved by Freeholder LaFour, second by Freeholder Lazara.
Freeholders Lazara,
yes.
LaFour,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Best.
Yes. Thank you. At this time, entertain a motion to resume regular order of business.
Move it.
Moved by Freeholder LaFour.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Bartlett. Roll call.
Freeholders Lazara,
yes.
LaFour,
yes.
Laura,
yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett,
yes.
Director Best.
Yes. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve proclamations.
Move it.
Moved by Freeholder LaFour.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Bartlett. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Lazara.
Yes.
LaFour.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Bass.
Yes. Are there any Freeholder reports?
Yes.
Freeholder Lazara.
I would like to report. Actually, this is a public service announcement. Mary Kaczynski, who is the director of our senior services, sent me some information. She wanted me to make an announcement that we will be sponsoring the annual senior art show running from May 31st until June 24th. It will be at the Department of Senior Services, 930 Riverview Drive, Suite 200 in Totowa. There will be over 80 pieces of art being displayed. The public is asked and encouraged to come to this. It's going to be a great display. And on June 24th, Friday, the awards reception will be at 2:00. Refreshments will be served, and you are invited to come. And the other art show I want to tell you about is going to be tomorrow night at 5:30 at Lambert Castle. Our Passaic County Technical Institute art students will be displaying their works of art up at the castle, and you are invited to come to that also. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I'm want to sort of add to that more general idea. I've certainly noticed that as the weather warms up and the summer comes, a lot more outdoor activities that are being offered by Passaic County and all of its various partners. I would encourage anybody out there who doesn't already to like Passaic County and Friends of Passaic County Park on Facebook. I'm trying to think of some in particular. I know that this weekend, we're not sure, next weekend, June 4th, there's a lecture at the Lambert Castle on the art and sculpture of Federici, who was one of the great artists of 19th century Patterson. But there's a whole lot going on, including as the summer goes on, programs in the park, our county fair in August. It's a great time to like and follow those outlets on Facebook and Twitter so you don't miss anything.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I have a couple quick things to report out. First, this past week we had a going home service or funeral service for a revered reverend and pastor, community leader in the city of Patterson in the county of Passaic, Reverend Albert Prince Rowe. Anyone who knew him, and a lot of people did because he was an institution in the city of Patterson in the county of Passaic, knows that he lived a very full and fulfilling life, very giving and generous person, and his services were done with all the respect and honor and dignity that he has earned in his long and illustrious life. So I just wanted to acknowledge the fact that the Freeholder Board in the County of Passaic did pass our well wishes to his family, to his congregation, and all of the loved ones that he lost, that he left behind. Secondly, yesterday we had the freeholders attended a special meeting for the Passaic County School Boards Association at Passaic County Tech. People who have been reading some of the wonderful articles in the newspaper, I just want to acknowledge the record for being here. Thank you so much for the outstanding work you do, sir. You would notice that there was some debate about the expansion at Passaic County Tech and the services offered at Passaic County Tech. And this was a chance for all of the boards of education throughout the county to come together and learn the offerings of Passaic County Technical Institute, learn about the fee structure, how their finances are set up, how their academies are set up, the services that they offer to our students, the services that they offer to other school districts within the county. And it was a very fruitful conversation. It was the first of a series of conversations that's going to be had between Passaic County Tech and the various school boards in the county. So that being said, I want to thank the freeholders who came out to hear and participate in this important meeting. I also want to thank the members of the school boards throughout the county who came out as well. It was a very respectful conversation, and I think that we started a really good dialogue. And lastly, tomorrow I have the opportunity of taking a group of approximately 45 students to Washington, D.C. for our annual Lautenberg train ride. Frank Lautenberg, who again was our great senator here in New Jersey, of Passaic County and a Patterson native, was the chairman of the Transportation Committee. And starting last year, this is our second year doing it, we have a group of students who paid tribute to Senator Frank Lautenberg, learn about our transportation system, and get to have a full day in Washington, D.C. So I'm really looking excited to take those students there. They'll have a chance to meet with the president and CEO of Amtrak. They're going to have a special charter train leaving out of Newark to take them to Union Station. Once they arrive at Union Station, they'll have a personal guided tour of that beautiful facility from the president of Amtrak and the president of their board. Then they are going to go and meet with the United States Secretary of Transportation, which should be really, really fun and exciting. Then they are going on to Capitol Hill to meet with our great Congressman Bill Pascrell. They're then going to meet with our United States Senator, Cory Booker. And the following day, we're going to take tours of the Capitol Building, the Smithsonian's, and the White House. So our students from the city of Patterson and the county of Passaic will have a great and wonderful experience learning about this country and learning about all the things that our very own Frank Lautenberg contributed. So thank you. Are there any other communications? Okay, I see it here. So at this time, entertain a motion to approve communications.
Move it.
Moved by Freeholder Laporte, second by Freeholder Laura. Roll call.
Freeholders Lazara.
Yes.
Laporte.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Bass.
Yes. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to open the public portions. Moved by Freeholder Laporte, second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call.
Freeholders Lazara.
Yes.
Laporte.
Yes.
Laura.
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett.
Yes.
Director Bass.
Yes. At this time, I'll ask anyone wishing to be heard from the public to please approach your podium. You have 3 minutes to be heard, and just want to remind everybody we got a nice new little feature up there of a clock that will let you know your time. Please be mindful and respectful. Thank you. And just for the record, we'll need your name and your address. You can get started. We'll try to give you a little extra time. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Start by that. Okay, to Troy County property, I read. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Can everybody hear?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
All right. First of all, Mr. Best, I'm going to get this off my chest. I am not here to bash anyone. I'm trying to give you a scholarly approach to a scenario that if you just listen, we can resolve it together. The name of their title of my presentation is Perceptions. On Thursday, April 21, 2016, we attended a budget meeting at the Seminary Baptist Church. And at that meeting, during the public portion, two participants communicated a couple of cogent points. It was suggested that during the grant awards process, the same participants are getting the grants, although they are duplicating and replicating the same service. Re-entry awards, for instance. What is the overall effectiveness and the residual effect of one-stop centers, interventions in the lives of potential applicants with special needs? For instance, older felons who have taken the initiative to help themselves long ago and now cannot buy employment because of increased scrutiny. It was suggested by Mr. Greg Bullard that the workforce is basically out of touch with the needs of Passaic County residents and is basically forcing certain applicants into ineffectual training loops. Duplicative services that enterprise and motivated individuals will attain anyway through their own initiatives. Since this meeting and subsequent logging of interactions with One Stop Center personnel, several bullet points and perceptions must be made regarding these interactions. There is a perception that One Stop Center should be renamed Stop Centers because progress towards employment stops when you arrive. It appears some Stop Center personnel are ill-equipped and insensitive to the varying needs of a diverse clientele and are out of touch with their clients' needs. Their client's initial Stop Center perception is shaped by Stop Center personnel. That is key. Clients that have taken the initiative to help themselves find Stop Centers particularly useless, often being placed in nebulous and unfulfilling training loop. The application of the original WIA, WIOB, WIB framework is flawed, causing the residual effect of negative perceptions and failed program. Basis for these conclusions, an 11-year relationship with labor workforce development interactions. Real-time empirical data compiled on a daily basis from the Neighborhood Assistance Office, client testimonials, a recruitment fair held on 5/23 that had less than enthusiastic results from clients and the alleged employers. Listen carefully, everyone. I am not asking you for a job or employment. I need funding to correct a problem that has been allowed to perpetuate because of lack of adherence to detail. Can this statement be verified? Sure. At 9:42 a.m. on Thursday, May 19, 2016, I spoke with the program manager for workforce development about employment prospects in the IT industry. He intimated it was a bad market for IT jobs, I know this to be untrue and suggested that someone needs to develop the leads and get the jobs. Ladies and gentlemen, by 4 p.m. that same afternoon, a jobs developer position was forwarded to the neighborhood assistance office. My question is, why did it take so long to realize a job developer is needed? I realized 11 years ago a jobs person was needed.
Sir, I'm going to ask that you please wrap it up.
Sure, I expected that. And by the way, if our research and comments are going to be acted upon, then we want funding to complete the mission. We will not act as unpaid free consultants to the county. You have people that are being paid salary and receiving funds to hypothesize and arrive at the solutions we can offer. Summary and conclusion. A white paper is being prepared that reflects the perceptions and realities of workforce interactions and how to fix it. The core data being compiled is derived from the Neighborhood Assistance Office, an entity that sits at the epicenter of the residual effects of inadequate or failed Passaic County or City of Patterson programming for core services. Lack of adherence to the original WIA, WIB, WIOB framework is a key component to the perception that one-stop centers should be renamed stop centers. I'm going to wrap it up because I have a few more. I'm just going to wrap it up like this, and I appreciate Mr. Best giving me additional time. Ladies and gentlemen, one-stop centers do not work. They are ineffectual. We have a solution. We just need the funding to do it. Whether you help us or not, ladies and gentlemen, we are proceeding full speed ahead with a revamp of one-stop centers, whether we get the assistance from the county or the city or not. I'm going to wrap it up by saying this. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a problem that has to be fixed. And you have scholars right in front of you. Everybody that can fix this problem is in this room right now. Right now. You don't need outside consultants. You have inside consultants. But I thank you for your time, and please don't sleep on this scenario with the one-stop centers. It's a ghost. It's going to come back to haunt
you. Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. And if you can, if you would like to leave a copy with that for us. No, that's fine. You get it to us later. It's all right.
Yeah, I'll email it to you.
All right, no problem. Perfect. Okay. I just want to make sure everybody has it. Thank you. Any other speakers?
Jay Cohen, 2319 Warren's Way, Wanakee. As you know, I've been speaking for a study to be done showing the effect that Passaic County Vocational Tech has on the local school districts. Let me talk today about the Ides of October. On October the 15th, state funding, federal funding that goes with each student and tuition payments that goes with each student is frozen in the school that the student is in. And it seems to be one of the reasons that after October 15th, local superintendents get calls from Passaic County Vocational saying, this student isn't working out too well here, why don't you take him back? It's a problem, and I don't know how many of you are aware of the problem. I want to know who monitors the financial programs, the use of funding at Passaic County Vocational Tech. The local schools have school boards, which are elected by the local people, so there is some accountability. I don't know how much accountability there is at Passaic County Vocational Tech. I also want to know how the superintendent of Passaic County Vocational Tech can far exceed the cap on superintendent's pay by about $100,000. It seems to me that this is not something that we should be allowing. There are many good things that are happening in the other schools in Passaic County, and I don't really hear much about them at this Freeholders Forum. For example, Clifton High School's robotic team earned 2 engineering awards in this year's First for Inspiration and Regeneration of Science and Technology Robotics World Championships. Uh, a math teacher at John F. Kennedy High School in Patterson won a national award from Johns Hopkins Center for Talented Teachers. Ricky Christensen, a senior at Passaic Valley High School, was honored for his artistic work at this year's Morris Museum's presentation. He was chosen as one of 50 students out of about 740 that applied, and this program will be going from April 9th through June the 7th at the museum. Hawthorne High School English teacher, Shana Tulio, was recently awarded the Montclair State University's English Department's Award for Excellence in Literary Studies. Many good things happen in the other schools. They don't always get mentioned here, and I just thought I'd mention them in spite of the fact that they are deprived of funding that they could use to better their programs. All I ask for is a study be done showing the impact of the Passaic County Vocational Tech School, which you're expanding apparently, on the local school districts. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
Seeing no one at the podium, good evening, everyone. I move to close the public portion.
I'll come back to that.
And for a second, Director, just a reminder, my three older colleagues are going to be there.
And second.
roll call, please.
Three olders. Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
Latour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Bass?
Yes. This time, entertain a motion for N1 with the as amended.
Thank you.
Move it.
Move by Freeholder Latour.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Duffy. Roll call, please.
Freeholder Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
Latour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. At this time, entertain a motion for 01 through 035.
Move it.
Move second. By Freeholder Latour.
Second.
Second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call, please.
Freeholder Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
LaFour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. This time moving to new business. Motion to approve personnel. Moved by Freeholder Bartlett.
Second.
Second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call.
Freeholders Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
LaFour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. Motion to approve the bills list. Moved by Freeholder Bartlett. Second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
LaFour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. Certification of payroll?
Move.
Moved by Freeholder Bartlett. Second by Freeholder LaFour. Roll call, please.
Freeholders Duffy?
Yes.
Lazara?
Yes.
LaFour?
Yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes. Receive department reports?
Received as well.
Great. Before we adjourn, I wanted to remind everybody that this evening, actually right now, we have our largest graduation from the Passaic County Police Academy ever taking place at Passaic County Technical Institute. We're all shooting up there right now. Hope you can join us. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
Sir, please make
that motion. Oh, excuse me. One second. Yes. Another thing, very important, civic engagement. I wanted to remind everybody that there is a primary election on June 7th. June 7th is New Jersey's primary election. Polls are open from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. Please make sure you go out and vote.
And also the Passaic County Memorial Day ceremony is going to be held this Thursday at 12:30 in the William Bate Memorial Courthouse Plaza outside 71 Hamilton. Please join us.
Just really briefly, I know that, that our clerk really worked really hard. I want to acknowledge that we got our team summit again this year with every single school throughout the county, all 16 municipalities gathered together to receive awards and scholarships funded by the County of Passaic. We had stellar students, once again, just to highlight that initiative, including all of the students in Passaic County.
Thank you. At this time, I entertain a motion to adjourn. Freeholder Duffy, second by Freeholder Lazara. Roll call.
Freeholder Duffy,
yes.
Lazara,
yes.
LaFour,
yes.
Laura?
Yes.
Deputy Director Bartlett?
Yes.
Director Best?
Yes, thank you all. Have a good evening.
Passaic County is a diverse place with both cities and suburban areas contrasted with the scenic beauty of our very rural areas. In 2010, we attended the Complete Streets Summit. It was an eye-opener. What we learned was streets are for everyone. Complete Streets better reflected our values and planning for the diversity of place, people, and choice. I guess you can say the summit started us thinking and brought us to the place that we are today, a county with a plan, policy, and an implementation strategy that we can be proud of.
A policy by itself isn't enough. We knew we needed to develop a decision-making process that outlined a vision, a policy, and design guidance that all mutually enforced each other. And that's what we did. Our policy was adopted in February of 2014 after 3 years of deliberate discussion, research, planning, and testing. The development of our transportation element of the master plan was the catalyst in the process. It created a forum for the planning and engineering departments to discuss the benefits of complete streets and how it could be applied to our county. Planning and engineering staff worked together to define a network of facilities in terms of land use and the context of each roadway that would have an impact on the feasibility, connectivity, and safety. So the Complete Streets guidelines serve as a pivot between the planning priorities and the engineering details outlined by New Jersey DOT and AASHTO. The policy was the final step in the process and has the distinction of being an implementation plan and not just a policy. The Complete Streets guidelines are just that, guidelines on how we implement Complete Streets. The guidelines aren't handcuffs and don't prescribe how everything should be done. They provide context and a decision-making tool in designing Complete Streets. It's really simple. Instead of projects standing alone on their own, they're now implemented within a framework of projects that show us the big picture of how Complete Streets work. So ultimately, I feel like we put together a very clear policy and planning framework, but success for us is going to be measured by outcomes. And in order to have outcomes, you have to have implementation.
Implementation of Complete Streets happens a few different ways and from a few different programs. We've made incredible progress through our resurfacing program. This is the low-hanging fruit that is inexpensive but very impactful. The way the resurfacing program works, we evaluate the roadway width and then decide under the Complete Streets guidelines what treatments we can do to each road. Between 2012 and 2015, we've implemented over 100 miles of Complete Streets treatments, including 33 miles of shared roadways, 15 miles of bicycle lanes, 54 miles of traffic calming, and 8 miles of road diet. A road diet reduces the number of lanes dedicated to motor vehicles and provides that width for the exclusive use of pedestrians and bicyclists. Basically, our engineering isn't pro forma book value implementation. Judgment and really thinking about the vision and our transportation system comprehensively is how we approach things. I know that people have concerns about complete streets, such as liability and traffic impacts. However, we were very confident in those two aspects because as long as we followed the accepted engineering standards, liability is not an issue at all. And as long as we do the proper traffic studies to assess the impact on traffic, then that also is not an issue. It's a better way of doing things, and we think it's been great for the county.
By authorizing a complete streets policy, we direct our planning and roads departments to incorporate these considerations into everything that they do, from major capital plans to annual restriping and resurfacing projects. The Freeholders Authorization also lets our municipalities know that we'll support and work with them to make complete streets a reality in every city and town. I'm proud that Passaic County has the most comprehensive complete streets policy in the state of New Jersey. It's something we've determined supports our communities, and it's something that we're going to support today and going forward.
People don't quite know what a freeholder is, don't quite understand what county government is. I'm here today to give you some information, explain what we do, so that you know what services and information you can get from your Passaic County government. Passaic County freeholders are 7 representatives of the 16 towns in Passaic County. We're from all over, we're from all different walks of life. Together, we've been elected to represent you in the level of Passaic County government. And as I say, the first question I often get is, what is a freeholder? Well, first of all, the term is kind of weird. It comes from the 1776 Constitution of the State of New Jersey, which was written at a time when, to be elected to govern your county, you had to own land without debt. So you had to be a free holder of your land. That rule is no longer in effect. You can rent and still be a freeholder. But the term endured, and today the Board of Chosen Freeholders of Passaic County has 7 members: our Freeholder Director, Hector Laura, Deputy Director, Bruce James, myself, Theodore T.J. Best, Rhonda Caston-Cotronio, Terry Duffy, Pat Lepore, and we function as both the legislature and the executive of Passaic County. Some counties have a separate office of the county executive. Here, we perform both of those functions, and the day-to-day operations of the county are managed by an administrator whom we employ. Passaic County comprises 16 municipalities, from urban centers like Patterson and Passaic, all the way up to places like West Milford and Ringwood, which are part of our state's up-county rural treasures. We have more than 502,000 residents, according to the most recent census. And we have, I really believe it, both a rich history and a bright future. That's the motto that we adopted in 2012 when we celebrated the 175th anniversary of Passaic County. And it really is true. From the Great Falls and Patterson as the first planned industrial community in the state of New Jersey or in the nation, all the way to the great things that we're doing now with a new national park at the Falls and other programs to bring Passaic County business, education, and life into the 21st century. What I want to do is explain the role of freeholder and put it in context for you just by using the letters of the word freeholders. And I want to start with the letter F. First and foremost, the freeholders are here for you. We are right in your neighborhood. We don't go to Trenton. We don't go to Washington to represent you. We're right here. We're your neighbors. You'll see us at the diner. You'll see us at the movie theater. You'll see me at ShopRite in Wayne because I'm the guy in charge of grocery shopping in my family. So we're available. We're accessible. We're right here where you need us, when you need us. And we try to be responsive anytime anybody reaches out to us, whether by telephone, by email, via our website, which has a special function which allows you to submit a question or an inquiry or a problem. And of course, as I say, just as you see us on the street around the community. The letter R stands for roads, bridges, and infrastructure. Your Passaic County freeholders maintain, repair, and repave all the county roads and bridges here in Passaic County. That's more than 240 miles of roads. It's 358 bridges. It's culverts and catch basins. And all of that is part of our jurisdiction. Our roads department, our engineering department make that happen. We also plan and supervise major road and highway projects. And I want to give you a couple of examples. In my town of Wayne, there's the intersection of Hamburg Turnpike and Valley Road. Over the course of 2012 and 2013, it was renovated, Hamburg Turnpike was widened, jug handles were added, and what that did was that cut the time for people getting through that intersection in half. And it also made it an overall safer intersection for that neighborhood. What we also did in conjunction with that, not only along the Valley Road extension, but along Ratzer Road, was a repaving and restriping project that, by doing what's called a road diet, has actually brought serious accidents on those roads down 45% by restriping. It's a simple simple thing to do, but it works and it keeps people safe. We've got a major project coming up at the confluence of Route 46 and Route 3 in Clifton, Little Falls, and Woodland Park, which I'm very excited about. This is a project that's been on the books since 2006 at NJDOT, and it was delayed again and again and again. I represent Passaic County on NJTPA, the North Jersey Transportation Planning Authority. And in 2013, when the governor tried to delay the project yet another time, I said, you know what, this is really important. 130,000 people go through this intersection every day. It's very, very dangerous. Anybody who goes through it, as I do most days, knows how important the project was. So funding moved forward, and we got $240 million in federal highway funding to make that happen. We're going to break ground in early 2016, and by a couple years later, it's going to be a transformed interchange. Getting in and out of Montclair State is going to be easier. Valley Road traffic is going to be moderated, and if you're heading, whether it's east or west, on 3 or on 46, you're going to feel safer, you're going to have an easier, quicker ride. We also have in Passaic County the most comprehensive complete streets policy in the state. And what that means is, as I was talking about restriping earlier, we're working to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to share our roads. The pedestrians are safe, the bicyclists are safe, and to the extent possible, have an integrated and connected set of bike lanes to get around Passaic County, because we have folks from all over Passaic County and all over northern New Jersey that love to ride their bikes up to the Apashua Reserve, or down to Garrett Mountain, or to the Great Falls. We're making sure that they can do that safely, and that all pedestrians and everybody on the roads can be safer. We're also focusing on transit-oriented development, trying to make it more possible for more people to get to work and play without using a car. That means developing areas around rail stations and bus stations, and it means working with NJ Transit and other regional authorities to make sure that opportunities are there for folks, whenever possible, to have a one-seat ride from where they're starting to where they end up. The E in Freeholders, the first E in Freeholders, at least, stands for education. We are a major source of secondary and higher education here in Passaic County. Specifically, for grades 9 through 12, we run what's called the Passaic County Technical Institute. It's a vocational technical school located in Wayne with 3,200 students in grades 9 through 12. It's a place where you can go to study the skilled trades, study healthcare to prepare for a career in nursing, also study business as well as a college prep curricula. Students come out of tech into all kinds of careers. They come out of our culinary institute into the great culinary schools and the great restaurants of New Jersey and the East Coast. They come out of our college prep and engineering curricula to places like MIT and Johns Hopkins. It's a school that we're very, very proud of, and it's one that your freeholders have invested in and are going to be continuing to invest in the coming years, with new opportunities for students to study the STEM subjects, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, because that's where the future is, and those are the jobs that can't be outsourced, that the children of today and the adults of tomorrow are going to have a chance to make a good living at. We also operate Passaic County Community College, which is a two-year college where you can go to get an associate's degree in any one of about 60 study areas. Now, the community college started out in Patterson, and we have invested in our main campus in Patterson. But we've also invested in campuses to make it accessible to more people. There's a campus in Wanacue, where by next year you'll be able to study all the same subjects as you can in downtown Patterson. There's campuses as well in Passaic and Clifton. So people who are right there in the community, whether the traditional students who just finished high school, or whether they're parents and older folks who are going back for a degree, can get that degree right there where they're at. The second E in Freeholders stands for Employment and Social Services. One of the major functions of government that happens at the county level here in New Jersey is providing social services. That's everything from employment opportunities, job training, and job boards, to things like food stamps and other nutrition assistance for children, Medicaid and other assistance for poor families and for people with disabilities and the elderly with respect to their medical care, temporary aid for needy families, emergency assistance, including rental assistance for families that are at risk of going homeless. Now, what we came to understand, myself particularly, as someone who sits on the board of social services, is that the information about these services were not getting out to everybody who needed them. Specifically, a quarter of our residents here in Passaic County are immigrants or the children of immigrants. And we found that English language facility was becoming a barrier to information and access here in Passaic County, particularly to the important services and resources that are provided by the Board of Social Services. So what we did for the very first time is we made information about the board and the things that are available there available to people, not just in English, but also in Spanish and in Bengali and in Arabic, because those languages are spoken by people across Passaic County whose families may have the needs that Passaic County Board of Social Services can solve. And we don't believe language should be a barrier to getting that information into their hands. These brochures are available at the county building. They're also going to be made available on the Board of Social Services website and across Passaic County at churches and mosques, at bodegas, and other places where folks might need to access this information. This is an initiative that we piloted over the past year, and I'm very proud of it. Board of Social Services also houses our one-stop career center, where our workforce investment board helps people get work, find opportunities for work, and also access a closet of clothing for job interviews and first jobs so that they can make a good impression and get that grab on the first rung of the economic ladder. H stands for healthcare, and I'm so proud of the healthcare facilities that our county provides. The flagship, of course, is the Preakness Healthcare Center located in Wayne. That's a 406-bed skilled nursing facility, and it's one of the only places in northern New Jersey to get certain specialized services like a pulmonary ward, a ward for the elderly mentally ill, a special ward to deal with folks suffering from Alzheimer's and other mentally degenerative diseases. The services that we provide at Preakness and the dignity and the quality of care and facility that we provide are something that I'm very, very proud of and something that all the freeholders are very, very proud of. And if you haven't seen Preakness, you really should go see it because it's a state-of-the-art facility and it's there for anybody who needs it, regardless of whether they can pay. We also have public health programs at the Passaic County level. We have got an Office of Health that deals with everything from preparedness for disasters and pandemics to providing routine health screenings to families and individuals in need. Also public health outreach and education. You may see us at the wintertime at Willowbrook Mall or at your township or city hall, providing information, providing screenings, giving people a chance to access healthcare information. Public Health Office also handles air and water quality inspection in Passaic County, as well as controlling pesticides and hazardous materials and regulating those here in Passaic County. The O in open space is open, the O in freeholders is open space and farmland preservation. In 1996, the taxpayers of Passaic County saw fit to pass an open space levy that's part of your property tax bill, and that funds municipal and nonprofit projects to preserve natural open space, to preserve farms, and to provide recreational facilities, everything from Little League fields in my town of Wayne and in Woodland Park and elsewhere, to soccer fields, to the maintenance of city parks, as well as the maintenance of our county park system, which I'll talk about in a couple of minutes. Now, those are the big checks that sometimes get written from the Open Space Fund, but we're also working at the very, very grassroots level. Through the Open Space Fund, we're funding a dig-in community garden project. And at churches and community centers and libraries all across Passaic County with small grants of $2,500 or $1,000. Local folks are establishing their own community gardens. Students are getting the chance to see how food is grown, to learn about good nutrition and a healthy diet. And through our partnership with City Green, they have the resources, the know-how, a tool bank, a seed bank, and other information so the community gardens can flourish across Passaic County. The L in freeholders stands for what probably for you as a resident is the most visible aspect of what we do, and that's law and public safety. Of course, there's the Passaic County Sheriff, Richard Burdnick, who is responsible not only for our county jail, but also for patrol around the county, for security at the courthouse and elsewhere. That's a good example of shared services, which is something that I'm going to come back to a little bit later in my presentation. We also have our Passaic County Prosecutor, Camelia Valdez, who's appointed by the governor, but whose office we fund in order to make it possible for her to prosecute criminals here in Passaic County and help keep Passaic County safe. In addition to courthouse maintenance and security, Passaic County also operates police and public safety academies, and that's a shared service example that I want to mention right now. That literally what we provide is the space and the people who operate it. And what that enables us to do in partnership with most of the municipalities here in Passaic County, as well as police forces in other counties and police forces at universities like William Patterson and Montclair State, is to train their cadets for free. And they in turn provide their senior officers as our faculty for free. Just by providing the building, we provide incredible savings and opportunity for law enforcement. And I've got to say, having seen the cadets and having seen the graduates, we provide a formidable training in law enforcement here in Passaic County. Finally, there's our Office of Emergency Management, also located up in Wayne. That's an office that can be the coordinating point in the event of a natural disaster. During Hurricane Sandy, for example, that was the place where law enforcement, health, education, other officers could come together, make sure everybody has the information they need, and go out and do what's needed to protect the citizens of Passaic County. The D and the E I put together because I'm particularly proud as the chair this year of the Planning and Economic Development Committee of the Freeholder Board of our work in the area of economic development. The Economic Development Division of Passaic County Government provides all kinds of free assistance to businesses here in Passaic County, from advice and help finding financing or finding a location for your business, to help with women, minority, or veteran-owned businesses to apply for that special status and have the opportunity to avail yourself of the special opportunities that come with being a woman-owned, a minority-owned, or a veteran-owned business. Assistance with redevelopment and understanding the rather complex rules sometimes of redevelopment under state law, as well as a bank program, EANC, which is our way of enabling municipalities, boards of education here in Passaic County to do more with less, to make the capital investments that they may need that are hard to fit into a single year's budget in a way that takes advantage of Passaic County's high AA credit rating to give them the opportunity to make purchases that would be tough to make in a single budget. And I'll give you an example. Again, I keep coming back to Wayne, which is where I live, but across Passaic County there are examples of this. Through the bank program, Wayne schools were able to purchase technology for students with disabilities. And those are, you know, sometimes expensive pieces of equipment, but because they could fund them through the bank program, they were able to provide them up front for all the kids that needed them. And that's something that I think is another example of what Passaic County offers to all of our municipalities. Moving on to the R, that's recreation and parks. And again, if you know a little about Passaic County government, you probably know about our parks. Garrett Mountain Reservation in Patterson, Rifle Camp Park in Woodland Park, Weaselbrook Park in Clifton along the Passaic border, Gofflebrook Park in Hawthorne, as well as our seven other county parks from Wayne all the way up to West Milford and Ringwood, the Dye Mansion, the Lambert Castle, some wonderful historical sites that we're very, very proud of maintaining. More than 16,000 acres of parks, as well as a golf course with two full 18-hole courses, an equestrian center in Garrett Mountain, an aquatic park in Wayne, and we're particularly proud over the last 2 years that we've revived the Passaic County Fair. If you haven't been to the Passaic County Fair, please come out next August and enjoy it. It's an exceptional opportunity. It's good family fun with rides and games and activities and delicious food from all over Passaic County. It's really a lot of fun, and that's the image that you can see in the background here. It was one of the nights up at the fair. We also have fireworks a couple of nights of the fair every year, which the kids just love. The S, we've come close to the end now. We're at the S, and that's Senior and Veteran Services. And we've made a commitment in Passaic County to look out for the people that built this county and this country and made it strong. We have Senior Citizens Day programs all across the county in virtually every municipality. We maintain Camp Hope up in West Milford, which is a destination not only for children from all over the county throughout the summer, but all year round for senior citizens to go up and enjoy a day out in nature, walk the trails, enjoy the buildings. If it's warm enough, take a swim in the pool or enjoy the spray park, although I think that's more the kids than the seniors. We have a Senior Citizen ID card program. Our Office of Weatherization and Home Energy Assistance can also help you paying the PSE&G bill and also get you the weatherization that your home may need to be more energy efficient. We've got folks that come out, look at your energy needs, do an audit, do the caulking or the re-stripping or whatever might help you save more money and be more environmentally conscious with respect to your own home. We also operate Meals on Wheels, which is such an important program. It's for folks who can't get out. It brings them healthy, hot meals every day. And it's also a really important point of contact for a lot of senior citizens. I was speaking to one of our Meals on Wheels drivers a couple of weeks ago, and he let me know about somebody who remarked that he was the only person that she saw most days. So that Meals on Wheels driver is a point of contact, and it's the person who will know if somebody needs help, if somebody's in distress. We think that's so important, and we're so proud of the Meals on Wheels program. Passaic County is also one of the only counties to have a veterans coordinator. John Harris is a Vietnam combat veteran, but more important, he's an advocate for every veteran in Passaic County, whether it's a new veteran of Iraq or Afghanistan who's trying to get access to their VA benefits, or whether, as happened last year, it was a World War II veteran who'd waited more than 65 years for the Purple Heart that he earned. John looked out for those folks. John looks out for all of our veterans. That's an important thing that Passaic County does, and it's something that we're proud of. All of these services together make Passaic County what's called an ADRC, an Aging and Disability Resource Connection. That's a designation nationally that says that if you need issues with aging, with disability, Passaic County is a point of contact, and Passaic County is a resource and information source for what you may need to know. There's one more S I'm going to share, and I know there's not two S's at the end of Freeholders, but one of the things that I think is important as people try to understand county government is to understand that because of the scale that we can do things at, and because we do represent 16 towns, more than 500,000 people, we can achieve savings through shared services and community involvement that are not easy to accomplish at the individual level. I mentioned earlier law enforcement, and there are good examples, particularly with the sheriff's office. We've got 16 towns in Passaic County. Some of them are huge, like Patterson and Passaic. Some of them are much smaller. Not every town needs its own crime scene lab. Not every town needs its own SWAT team. Not every town needs its own river and aquatic rescue equipment. That's expensive stuff. What we do at Passaic County is through the sheriff's office, those are available to all of our towns, whether it's Clifton or Ringwood or Totowa or West Milford. Police who need crime scene investigation and that special laboratory work that we all love to watch on television, that happens at the sheriff's level. So not every municipality has to have those trained staff and have those resources that, again, are so expensive. By doing that in one place for so many towns, we're able to save everybody money, and we're able to reduce the burden on individual municipalities and taxpayers as well. The same is true of SWAT, the Special Weapons and Tactics, and some of our other specialized sheriff's vehicles, like a mobile command center for law enforcement. That can go anywhere. That's part of a partnership with law enforcement in every municipality here in Passaic County. And I think it's a really good example. I think Passaic County Tech is another excellent example. Not every town in Passaic County could have an excellent, exceptional technical high school with all of these programs and this wonderful facility that's up there. But 16 towns together can, and that creates a wonderful opportunity for every kid from Passaic all the way up to West Milford and Ringwood. And talking about Passaic County Tech brings up another example of how Passaic County government can add value to our communities. Passaic County Tech has an athletic center with an indoor pool. Well, of course, Passaic County Tech's a high school. Folks are up there Monday through Friday. What we realized through our contact with the parents and families of kids affected by autism is that a lot of them had concerns about their children's safety around the pool and about the fact that it was difficult for children with those special needs to learn to swim. Well, we opened up the Passaic County Technical Institute Athletic Center on Saturday mornings for a swim team of kids with autism. I'm so proud that our clerk of the board, Lewis Imhoff, is one of the people who goes up there and volunteers to teach these kids to swim. It's a facility that's there. It's available to the community. By making that connection, we're helping a lot of kids learn basic water safety. And sometimes there's that kid where swimming is what he really takes to, and it brings him out of his shell. And it's just a marvelous, marvelous thing to see, and it's something that we're very, very proud of. Those are examples of what I call economies of scale, or I guess I should say economists call economies of scale. At the scope of Passaic County, we can invest in things, whether it's parks or law enforcement or healthcare or Meals on Wheels, in ways that it's efficient. We can share services across counties, and I'll give you two examples. We provide Meals on Wheels not only for ourselves but also for Sussex County. That helps relieve the burden on the Passaic County taxpayer. And when we closed our juvenile detention center a couple of years ago, shortly before I came on the Freeholder Board, we started sending those kids to the juvenile detention center down in Essex County in Newark. Now, that had two important effects. First of all, the Newark facility is nationally renowned for the quality of restorative, recuperative, maybe those aren't the right words, the kind of care that people, that those young people get to minimize their likelihood of recidivism, to maximize their educational outcome, their positive social outcomes. So we're sending kids from Passaic County who need that kind of custodial care to a place that does it really well. Second, and I think even more important for so many families here in Passaic County, is this. Because of that shared service arrangement and because of the distance to Essex County, we're sending fewer kids every month than the month before down into those facilities. Instead, our juvenile court is working with families to have intensive community supervision, to have kids getting the resources that they need while they stay in their own home. That keeps them out of the facility. It keeps them with their families, and it improves the outcomes as well. So not only did that save us $10 million by closing that facility, it's really improved the lives of the kids who are in the system, and it's something we're very, very proud of. Over the last 5 years, Passaic County has earned 4 consecutive upgrades in its credit rating. And Passaic County now has the highest credit rating in history, and that is a AA credit rating from Standard & Poor's. What that means is that when Passaic County does take on debt by doing what's called bonding, we do so at a much lower rate. Now, bonding or taking on debt is like what you may do to buy a house or to buy a car. By having a higher credit rating, just like you probably get a better mortgage rate or a better car loan rate if your credit rating is high than if your credit score is low, it's the same thing with us. We're saving $4 to $6 million a year just by refinancing old debt at our new better rates. Plus, it gives us the opportunity to make those investments that Passaic County needs at minimal cost to the taxpayer. We're going to keep on staying vigilant with respect to the conservative financial budgeting that we do. We're going to watch that because that credit rating and those upgrades are really priceless for the residents of Passaic County and for what we are able to do. And we try and always make county resources available to communities. If you've got a community organization, a church, a nonprofit, a parents association, a senior group, you want us to come out and talk to you, you want us to come out and provide health screenings, information on services for kids with autism or adults with disabilities, information on our county surrogate's office and the work that surrogate judge Bernice Toledo does in the area of guardianships for elderly people, adoptions and family support, just let us know. Reach out to our office. Give us an opportunity to get out there and provide you the information that we can and provide you and connect you with the county resources that are available to you and your family and your community. So with that, I want to thank you for taking the time to listen. I appreciate it on behalf of Freeholder Director Hector Laura, Deputy Director Bruce James, and all of my colleagues on the Freeholder Board. It's our privilege to serve you, and it's always exciting we can explain people what it is we do as Freeholders. Never hesitate to reach out to me personally or to any of your Freeholder representatives for any questions that you have about Passaic County government. Thank you so much.
Passaic County embraces the heritage of the nation, the headquarters of the Revolutionary War, the birthplace of American industry, a center for contemporary art. Come, explore a diverse landscape, the castles and museums, as history unfolds before you. Starting our tour at Morris Canal Park and Nature Preserve, a visitor is struck by the serene natural beauty surrounding him. Now a picture-perfect setting for artists and brides, one tends to forget that this canal was the only one in the country that climbed mountains by use of locks and inclined planes, traveling between the Hudson and Delaware rivers. This waterway, conceived in 1820, lined Pennsylvania's coal fields, New Jersey's iron industry, and New York's commercial markets. For a century, it flowed between the Delaware and Hudson rivers and extended from Phillipsburg to Jersey City. The canal was made obsolete by the railroad, closed to navigation, and abandoned in 1924. The Clifton Historical Commission approached the City Council with a defined plan and started the physical labor in April 1986 with Troop 22 of the Boy Scouts of America. As work progressed, community service people were used on a regular basis to have water in the former canal once more. At present, 19 Eagle Scouts have constructed projects in the park. Volunteers have maintained the gardens. The former waterway is now stocked with a variety of fish. More than half a dozen ducks are permanent residents and divide their time between the pond and the canal. It's a bit of history and nature in the middle of a busy city for all to enjoy. The Hamilton Van Wagner House welcomes the visitor to the pioneer homestead that once dotted what was known as the Old Aquackanock. With its graceful gambrel roof and red sandstone, the house reflects many of the characteristics of the architecture of early New Jersey Dutch colonists. The Hamilton Van Wagner House represents the ordinary people who toiled and shaped the nation, the farmer down the road, the tradesman in the village, the housewife in her kitchen, the artisan in the shop. All of the anonymous Americans who lived life as we do today, occupied in their daily work, their families, the celebration of life's joys and sorrows. These ordinary people communicate to us, their descendants, through simple objects they used in their everyday existence: the spinning wheel, a foot warmer, a crude basin, an elaborately decorated pitcher. Each room in the house reflects the different lives of the various families who called it home. Throughout the year, authentically dressed volunteers describe early 19th century life as they guide guests through the house. On Sundays, visitors can see early cooking skills demonstrated at the open hearth, cultural events and craft programs, typical of the period, as well as lectures and other events, are held at the museum. Our ancestors' lives do touch us. They reach out from the past through their possessions, now on exhibit at Hamilton House. Lambert Castle, originally known as Belle Vista, was built in 1892 as the home and showplace of silk manufacturer Catalina Lambert. The 53-acre estate originally included the main house, a gatehouse, a carriage greenhouse complex, and formal Italian gardens. In 1896, Lambert added an art gallery and observation tower. Lambert was born to working-class parents in England in 1834. At the age of 17, he and a younger brother came to America. Lambert settled in the Boston area, starting out as a bookkeeper. Lambert gradually bought a partnership into the firm Dexter Lambert. Its base of operation was relocated to Patterson, which in 1867 was emerging as a world-class silk manufacturing center. To accompany his rise in fortune, Lambert built a new home befitting his station as one of Patterson's leading industrialists. Belle Vista was constructed of sandstone, quarried from Garrett Mountain. The interior of the castle was organized around a three-story open atrium space called the court, where Lambert displayed many of his fine European and American paintings. His art collection included works by Rembrandt, Renoir, Courbet, Monet, and Blakelock. The rooms surrounding the gallery were the entry hall, formal dining room, drawing room, music room, study, and breakfast room. These rooms were used mainly for entertaining. The upstairs rooms were used by the family and guests, and the third floor housed servants' quarters. The interior decoration of the castle reflected the eclectic taste of the Gilded Age. In 1914, Lambert was forced to mortgage his estate and art collection. In 1916, several hundred pieces of art were auctioned off at the Plaza Hotel in New York City by American art galleries, now Sotheby's. Lambert was able to pay off his creditors and managed to live out the remainder of his life comfortably at the castle until his death in 1923, just several weeks shy of his 89th birthday. The castle was purchased and renovated for park system use in 1928, and a three-story atrium closed. In 1934, the Passaic County Historical Society established its museum in the castle, which presently serves as headquarters for the Passaic County Department of Parks and Recreation, the Passaic County Historian, and the Historical Society. Passaic's Hungarian Folk Museum is located at the Reed Library on 3rd Street. The museum, in two rooms on the second floor of the public library, features an eclectic collection of artifacts of Hungarian history and culture. Our intention is to keep and preserve the Hungarian culture and folklore, says the curator. Most of the museum's donations come from local Hungarian emigres, their children and their grandchildren. The museum features colorful ornate embroideries, wood carvings, regional costumes, photographs, books and newspapers, including a Hungarian language daily, first published in Passaic shortly after the turn of the century. The exhibits are celebrations of tradition. The American-Hungarian Museum, Passaic, was established to preserve, exhibit and cultivate Hungarian culture in one of the largest Hungarian communities in the United States. The museum specializes in community memorabilia, valuable folk art, folk crafts, costumes, embroideries, and examples of fine art. The museum also hosts special exhibits, lectures, performances, video presentations, and workshops. Patterson can be called aptly the cradle of American industry. It was near the Great Falls of the Passaic that plans for an industrial metropolis were developed at the end of the 18th century. The Lenni Lenape first found a home along the banks of the Passaic, and the Dutch settlers came here as early as 1679. However, it was not until the young American nation charted its course for independence that the industrial power potential of the Great Falls was realized. Strategically situated between the New York and Philadelphia markets, the Great Falls was considered an ideal site. In 1791, then Secretary of the Treasury, Alexander Hamilton, helped promote a private state-chartered corporation, the Society for Establishing Useful Manufacturers, SUM. It was through Hamilton's influence that the directors of the SUM located the town of Patterson at Great Falls. The new town was named for William Patterson, then governor of New Jersey. The corporation planned to utilize the falls by supplying water power through a three-tiered raceway system. The city produced textile machinery, revolvers, steam locomotives, silk, Holland submarines, Wright aircraft engines, and many more products. The SUM continued its corporate existence well into the 20th century. In 1945, its property assets, charter rights, hydroelectric power plant, and raceway system were sold to the city of Patterson. A visit to the Great Falls Historic District would be incomplete without a stop at the Patterson Museum, located in the restored Thomas Rogers Locomotive Erecting Shop. Owned and maintained by the city of Patterson, the museum was organized in 1925. Its first exhibit, displayed in the assembly room of the Danforth Public Library, consisted of natural history items donated by local residents. 2 years later, the growing collection was moved to the adjacent carriage house of former Mayor Nathan Barnett, and within a few years became one of the state's largest mineral collections. Persons with an interest in the industrial age will enjoy looking over the dyeing, winding, warping, weaving, and jacquard loom products that gave Patterson its worldwide reputation in silk and textiles. The museum has the finest collection of Patterson-made firearms in East Coast institutions. During his tenure in Patterson, Samuel Colt produced approximately 2,850 pistols. Changing exhibits complement the museum's permanent displays. For several years, the museum had featured the work of local and metropolitan artists. Individuals who enjoy historical research will also find ample documentary resources on city history, which include the papers of submarine inventor John Philip Holland, as well as his submarine, original manuscripts, and a photograph collection consisting of over 50,000 negatives and prints. The Broadway Gallery of Passaic County Community College is a vital part of the Cultural Affairs Department's program. The gallery, which began in 1979, sponsors a full schedule of monthly exhibits by a broad range of national and international artists, as well as by local artists. Recent art exhibits include an extensive retrospective exhibition by WPA artists, exhibitions by Edward Ruga, Kimberly Camp, Zoltan Hecht, Ben Jones, Alicia Morey, and many other artists from diverse cultural backgrounds. The Broadway Gallery features several important works of art that are part of the college's permanent collection. A life-size metal sculpture of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. by noted African-American artist Henry Simon is on display at all times. A 65-foot mural by artist John Traynor depicts the history of Patterson. In addition, the permanent collection contains a signed lithograph by Ben Shawn of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., an unextended loan from the collection of Cynthia Reese, five paintings by African-American artist Kimberly Camp from her Here I Talk to My Ancestors series. The gallery features monthly exhibitions of contemporary art with an emphasis on multicultural and ethnic artists. The American Labor Museum advances public understanding of the history of work, workers, and the labor movement in the United States, with special attention to the ethnicity and immigrant experience of American workers. It is headquartered in the historic Botto House National Landmark, the 1908 home of Pietro Maria Botto, immigrant silk mill workers from northern Italy. It played a major role in the reform of the American workplace. In the winter of 1913, more than 24,000 men, women, and children marched out of Paterson, New Jersey's silk mills, calling for decent working conditions, an end to child labor, and an eight-hour day. From January to July, constant mass arrests and hostile city authorities threatened the safety of the strikers and their families. Pietro Botto offered his home as a meeting place for the strikers. Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, Upton Sinclair, and other champions of the cause of labor spoke from the second floor balcony to workers of many nationalities. The American Labor Museum works to remember the sacrifices of these and other workers who have advanced the cause of working people. The museum has sponsored a variety of activities, including conferences and cultural programs. It maintains a collection of artifacts illustrating the lifestyle of immigrants and working people's involvement in the labor movement. This landmark structure contains period rooms, gardens, and contemporary gallery space for changing exhibits. The Ben Shawn Gallery at William Patterson College is a contemporary gallery consisting of three gallery rooms accommodating 1,000 visitors per year. Entering Ben Shawn Gallery, a visitor walks through a sculpture garden made up of large and small pieces. The three galleries feature changing group exhibitions based on a theme or unifying principle and one-person shows. The Ben Shawn Gallery is representative of tri-state area artists and alumni. The exhibits are curated by the gallery director and by guest curators from among the art department faculty. All the mediums taught within the department are represented in the exhibition schedule, since the gallery is an important resource for both students and faculty in the department. Painting, sculpture, photography, printmaking, textile design, ceramics, and furniture design. Here we see an alumni exhibit which reflects those careers for which students are trained, packaging, and award-winning computer animation. The gallery sponsors lectures and gallery tours. Of particular interest is Art at Lunch, which is a series of 14 thematic lectures offered on Thursdays, presented by gallery docents and art faculty. The Dye Mansion, Washington's headquarters museum, is a Georgian manor house built in the 1740s by Dirk Dye, whose Dutch grandfather came to New Amsterdam before 1641. Dirk's son, Tunis, served his county and state in an official capacity throughout his lifetime. During the Revolutionary War, he was colonel of the Bergen County Militia. This important military position brought Dye in constant communication with General George Washington. Because of its strategic position relative to British-occupied New York City and its accessibility to food and forage, the Preakness Valley was chosen by Washington as a site for the encampment of his army. In 1780, Washington's headquarters were established at the Dye home. Washington departed Dye Mansion for various campaigns. In November 1780, he and his troops left for their winter encampment. Historical research disclosed that hundreds of letters and orders were actually written at the mansion by and on behalf of General Washington and directed to senior officers as well as to the Continental Congress. Many famous men passed through the portals of the Dye Mansion besides Washington. They include Nathaniel Greene, Alexander Hamilton, Marquis de Lafayette, Lord Stirling, and Anthony Wayne. The Dye family owned the house until 1801, when it passed into other private hands. In 1930, the Passaic County Park Commission purchased the estate as part of its acquisitions for Preakness Valley Park. After restoration work was completed, the museum was opened to the public in 1934. Today, it is owned and operated by the Passaic County Department of Parks and Recreation and is open for public enjoyment year-round, where one can follow in Washington's footsteps. The Van Riper Hopper House was built in 1786 by Uri Van Riper when he married Polly Burdan. Remaining in the Van Riper family, the house was bequeathed to Uri's great-granddaughter, Mary Ann Van Riper, who married Andrew Hopper in 1872. On July 6, 1964, the house was officially dedicated as the Wayne Township Museum. The Van Riper Hopper House is a fine example of Jersey Dutch architecture. It is a one-and-a-half-story building with five first-floor rooms and four upstairs bedrooms. Typical of the Jersey Dutch style, the house faces south and receives full benefit of the sunlight. There are six fireplaces in the house. Some of the floors are original wide pine planks. Open ceilings are supported by heavy hand-hewn beams. A mortar of clay, straw, and hair holds the walls of stone in place. Plaster on the inside walls is an inch thick. The house is furnished with many fine antiques. The museum complex includes the Van Dyne House and the Archaeological Laboratory. The Archaeological Laboratory contains thousands of artifacts excavated from local sites, many dating back to Indian tribes who roamed the area thousands of years ago. Situated adjacent to the Point View Reservoir, the museum, with its spacious grounds, beautiful flower beds, and herb gardens, offers a peaceful oasis in which to relax and enjoy a picnic. The New Jersey Botanical Garden at Skylands and Ringwood State Park is the centerpiece of a property assembled by Francis Lynn Stetson from Pioneer Farmsteads in the Ramapo Mountains. Stetson named his country estate Skylands, and here he maintained a stylish mansion of native granite, a working farm with more than 30 outbuildings, gardens, and a vast lawn that also served as a nine-hole golf course. The gardens cover an extensive area. The terrace gardens behind the manor house and the flower gardens across Maple Avenue are an easy and delightful walk. Skylands was sold in 1922 to Clarence Mackenzie Lewis, an investment banker and trustee of the New York Botanical Garden. Lewis decided to make Skylands a botanical showplace. The Stetson House was torn down, and it was replaced by a Tudor mansion of native granite that we see today. Lewis engaged the most prominent landscape architects of his day to design the garden. Most of the trees now framing the house were planted at that time, including the magnificent copper beeches. Lewis stressed symmetry, color, texture, form and fragrance in his gardens. For 30 years, Lewis collected plants from all over the world and from New Jersey roadsides, resulting in one of the finest collection of plants in the state. In March 1984, Governor Thomas Kane designated the 96 acres surrounding the manor house as the state's official botanical garden. Included among the annual garden are the crabapple vista, the perennial border, the summer garden, the winter garden, the magnolia garden, the azalea garden, and the octagonal garden. In October 1984, Skylands was visited by John D. Bond, keeper of the gardens of England's Windsor Great Park, who manages all the garden holdings of the British royal family. Bond was so impressed by the tremendous variety of mature plants that on his departure, he took with him seeds for germination in England. Established in 1740, Ringwood is to industry what Williamsburg, Virginia is to politics. It produced munitions for every major armed conflict, from the French and Indian War to World War I. The Ringwood iron mines operated intermittently from the 1920s until they ceased operations in 1957. Martin Ryerson began construction of the present-day Ringwood Manor after he purchased the Ringwood properties in 1807 from the American Iron Company. The small federal-style home he built is a fraction of the current structure. Eventually, the property was sold to the firm of Cooper Hewitt and Company. Mr. Hewitt married Amelia Cooper, his partner's sister, in 1855. In the spring of 1856, they made Ringwood Manor their permanent home. It was during the Hewitts' occupancy that the house was expanded and acquired its current Victorian appearance and saw entertaining on a grand scale. As a wealthy businessman, Hewitt had the social responsibility to entertain his peers. These responsibilities increased during his political career, which encompassed the Democratic National Chairman, a one-term mayor of New York City, and congressman from New York. Their country home became known locally as the Second White House. The present structures reflect the period from 1854 to 1936, when the Hewitts resided at the manor and used it as their country estate. One can visualize Hewitt as the lord of his manor house and 33,000 acres of property. He relaxed from the pressures of business and the congenial company of family and friends. In planning the gardens, Hewitt was inspired by the classical designs used for the palace grounds at Versailles. Today, Ringwood Manor houses a splendid collection of furnishings, Hudson River School paintings and prints and lithographs, reflecting the personal preferences of a family estimated to have amassed the sixth largest personal fortune in America. We conclude our tour in the northern reaches of Passaic County's Highlands region at Long Pond Ironworks. This rugged country, stretching from Pennsylvania to New York State, holds rich deposits of iron ore. Long Pond Ironworks was founded in 1766 as a colonial iron-making community. This colonial furnace, presently in ruins, produced iron to make armaments for the Continental Army during the Revolutionary War. Robert Erskine, ironmaster at that time, also served as surveyor general to General George Washington. Here we see the Civil War era furnaces, complete with casting house. Built by Abram S. Hewitt and Peter Cooper around 1862, this industrial complex produced iron used in making gun barrels for Union troops during the Civil War and was partly responsible for the Northern victory in 1865. This site's existing buildings and the remains of the industrial complex testify to more than 100 years of technological evolution and to Long Pond's contributions to local, state, and national history. The three structures seen here are among the surviving residential buildings at Long Pond Ironworks. Each is part of the Registered Historic District and is targeted for restoration. Visit Passaic County, where a past rich in history combines with a future rich in promise. Passaic County is in the heart of North Jersey and on the pulse of the global film industry. It has stunning natural resources, urban, suburban, and rural locations, convenient access within the tri-state area, and state-of-the-art telecommunications. The Commission has also created a filmmaker's resource guide. It allows location scouts, producers, and directors a snapshot of what Passaic County offers, as well as a list of local contacts throughout the county. Several productions for both the small and large screens have used the county and its communities for their sets. The Sopranos have filmed scenes all over the county, and they have given us rave reviews. Many feature films have been shot in Passaic County communities. Recently, a new film, The House is Burning, was shot in Wayne and Hawthorne. Move over, Hollywood. Here's the clip. The all-volunteer Passaic County, New Jersey Film Commission is hard at work raising the visibility of our county locally and nationally. Eventually, this will result in more productions within the county and increased economic benefits to the businesses that call Passaic County home. If you are contemplating a major or independent production, we want you here.
Are you a filmmaker looking for the perfect location? Then Passaic County is for you. Our county is home to 16 production-friendly municipalities that feature wonderful urban, suburban, and rural locations. Passaic County also has historical and cultural sites, botanical gardens, parklands, and castles. Easily reached and is 30 minutes from New York City. For more information, call the Passaic County Film Commission at 973-881-4427.